okay, Minister Love. Look, I'm going to put you on a little early, but you still stay on until 11:15, okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay, stand by for me.
Okay.
For the past 30 minutes, you have been listening to the Nature's Formula radio broadcast. You're in tune to 1400 AM WPCE, Portsmouth, Norfolk. I'm the brother Donald L. Eason. Good morning. At this time, we will now join the radio broadcast of the Love Bot radio broadcast with your radio minister, Minister Love. Good morning to you, Minister Love. You're now on the air.
Good morning, Mr. Eason, and good morning to you, lovelies. And once again, we're back in the place to be on Saturday morning at 11 o'clock a.m., and that is the Love Spot. It is a pleasure to be in your ear-listening presence. So I don't have anyone with me today. Miss G had another obligation. I thought she was going to make it in, but we're going to keep on keeping on as we normally do. I want to talk today about tattoos and piercings and, you know, because I'm thinking about whether I should get me a piercing. I'm going to be honest with y'all because y'all know I'm transparent. I did have one, and I'll tell you that story a little later. But let's see what the Bible tells us. I did a little research, and in Leviticus 19:28, it says, "You shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor tattoo any marks on you. I am the Lord." And then this is the verse that we as Christians often use to argue about abstaining from having tattoos. But, you know, we have to always look at the context of the scripture. You know, we have to remember who it was written for, what, when it was written, why it was written. And the surrounding text around this specifically addresses the pagan religion, the rituals that they had. It's in verse 26, it states, "Do not eat meat that has not been drained of its blood." In verse 27, "Do not trim off the hair on the temples or trim your beards." And we, of course, know that we all still eat meat. Some of us like it red and runny, and some of us, most of the men trim their beards. So, I mean, we always take out what part of the Bible we want to follow. So since we're not following that part, is it a problem that we don't follow the part that we get tattoos? Or is this scripture pertaining to us? Or was it pertaining to the pagan rituals? You know, was it really telling us as Christians that we should not get tattoos and piercings? See, obviously, and this is what I researched, is that most Christians who say the Bible forbids tattoos still eat non-kosher meats and get the haircut. So that's what I was just discussing. And so it says, so should we Christians not get tattooed or not get haircuts or not eat kosher meats? So on a deeper look, these customs, along with sacrificing babies and burning altars and providing your daughters as prostitutes, were practiced in the pagan rituals. And that's what I was just saying, that the pagan rites and rituals, that's when they did all this stuff. And we know we don't practice that. Scholars believe that tattooing and cutting of the skin were related to the mourning for the dead. And the pagan worshipers of this region disfigured their bodies to appease the anger of their gods and find help for the deceased. So my thing is whether I should get me a piercing, because I'm thinking about getting one right in my nose, you know, because. But the only thing is, I might have sinus problems. I don't know how well that's going to work for me because I'm constantly messing with my nose. But I always wanted a little tiny diamond right on the corner of my nose. So I'm still trying to decide whether or not I should get another piercing. And, you know, so should we as Christians get piercing. Now, I need y'all to talk back to me. I got some of you on the internet, on social media. Tell me what you think about Christians and piercings. You know, the Bible actually has mentions of body jewelry and piercings, you know, nose rings and earrings. The body jewelry was actually used in dowries for marriages, and also it was used for currency. So if it's in the Bible that they wore the jewelry and it was, you know, actually respected, do that mean that we can't have body piercings, or do that mean that it's okay for us to have body piercings as Christians? I mean, you know, archaeologists have found Hebrew body jewelry used for piercing in their digs across the modern day Israel. So this is something that was going on. This was norm. You know, this in some parts of Israel, it actually could have been their cultural to have the body piercings, you know. So it was like, what side were you on? What culture were you on? Because a lot of times, you know, in our own cultures, we believe in some things over here, and we don't believe in the same thing over here. So, you know, just like shaking with your left hand, where is it? I think it's in Israel, Pakistan. It's one of those foreign places where if you shake with your left hand, you're actually threatening to kill somebody. So you have to think about all of that. What was the culture at that time? You know, so, but people still argue that the piercings and tattoos and Christianity, you know, about that. We still debate about whether or not we should have a tattoo. Now, listen, check this out. Because what do we think God thinks about us with our tattoos and our piercings? Well, let's go in 1 Samuel 16:7. It says, the Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Jesus rebuked the Pharisees for being whitewashed tombs, meaning they were clean on the outside but dead in the inside. So the Bible clearly states throughout the entirety of the scripture that God looks at the heart. So is he really paying attention to our tattoos? Is he paying attention to our piercings? I mean, I have earrings. What makes that different from a nose ring or lip ring or eyebrow ring? It's still a piercing. We cannot depict what we're going to say is right and what we're going to say is wrong. It's still a piercing. A sin is still a sin. Remember, we always want to decide what sin we're going to adhere to and what sin we're going to dismiss. You can't do it. You either hot or you're cold. There's no lukewarm. So the piercing issue, I'm thinking it's already a done deal because most of us already have piercings. Okay, so what does the, you know, like I said, you argue about what the tattoo means. I do think when everything that we do, we must do it within decency, you know, in order. We must do it unto God. Everything that we do unto him. So if we're going to get a tattoo, and I'm not authorizing this for anybody but for Minister Love, I'm going to make my decision. You have to make your decision based on what you believe in. But what I'm trying to say that if we do this, if you decide to get a tattoo, it needs to be decent and in order. So we're not going to get anything on our bodies that's permanent, that's going to be negative, that is not going to be of him, that's going to be something that looks bad. You understand what I'm saying? If I got a tattoo, which I'm not going to get tattooed because I can't take the needle and the poking and stuff like that, I wouldn't be able to do that. But if I was able to do that, I may get something relatable to my name. So I'll probably get a heart, or I might get the big L, Love, and with a heart and all that stuff. But I would never get something that's trashy on my body, you know, because I do want to still represent he who loves me, he who represents me well, he who takes care of me. So we have to be mindful of that. And we don't want to be offensive as Christians, you know, because, I mean, just think about it. and let's use this example that I ran across when I was doing my research. When it comes about pantyhose, Christians would say women in Italy, Italian example. Today, Christians would say that women can't wear pantyhose. However, pantyhose was originally worn by prostitutes in Italy centuries ago. It was extremely identifying. It was an identifying mark for prostitutes to let others know of their service. Okay, thus centuries ago in Italy, Christian women would not have worn pantyhose merely to avoid adorning themselves with articles that would identify them with prostitution. So that's what I'm saying. What is the culture? What is going on at that time? Why was this written? Why was this put into effect about the tattoos and the piercings? And I think I've answered it because it was the pagan religion that actually discussed worshiping the dead with your tattoos and your piercing. But as we go further on into our Bible, we see that tattoos and piercings were actually adored. That, you know, it was respectable. It was like I said, a dowry. It was given at marriage, and so it was something that they did that was actually cultural. And it was normal. And so how should we perceive it today? Because we have so many Christians out here that want to make up their own rules and want to read the Bible and not be open-minded. We don't want to see the other side or hear the other side of someone else's opinion or how they interpret what the word says. Now, as I interpret the word, I don't see a problem with getting the tattoos or the piercings. I just don't, as long as they're in good taste and it does not present a negative aspect of our Lord and Savior. Can Christians get tattoos and piercings? That's the question for those of you who are just tuning in. It's a type of adornment. It's an accessory in our culture. It's much like a hat and a scarf now. I mean, it is so culturalized in 2019, and we still have people arguing about people wearing tattoos. Come on, we wear makeup, our hair, jewelry. I just personally don't see anything wrong with it as long as it's in good taste. But we all have our interpretation of what we believe the Bible is saying to us. So, I have to respect you, and I ask that people respect me. And see, that's the whole thing to me about living for Christ. We have to learn to love each other anyhow. Because regardless of what you fear, regardless of what you think, or regardless of you feeling that I'm not doing something appropriately, you still have to love me. That's what you have to do. That agape love, that love that doesn't require any feelings, that love that just requires you to care enough, be obedient to God's word, okay? That's the love that you need to show me. And then you don't need to worry about what I do. Pray for me. If I'm adamant about doing something that I believe is good for me, and that's anybody, whatever their decision is, love them anyhow. Love them anyhow. And so let's close this part up and say, what does the Bible say about tattoos and piercings? Here are some thoughts. While the Bible does not address tattooing for adornment purposes, it does say, So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And that's what I was just saying. That's 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whatever we do for the glory of God. Tattoos are powerful. They're permanent. They're messages. And several of those messages now, like I said before, they don't line up with the Bible. But we need to make sure as Christians, if we decide to get us that tattoo, our messages that we send are lined up with the Bible. They're decent. They're in order. They're not obscene and racist, okay? We don't want none of that stuff on our bodies, especially permanently. We still want to display Christian behavior and Christian values, okay? So I just wanted to talk about that. I don't know whether I'm going to get anything or not. I do a lot of talking when it comes to those type of things. But let me just announce this right quick. And if I have time, I'm going to give y'all a story. On Sunday, November 17th, Maurice Yancey and One Accord is having their anniversary. And it's featuring Dara Pettis and Taken, the Wells Brothers, the Virginia Heirs, and Sisters. Their admission is, in advance is $15, and at the door is $20. Show starts at 5 o'clock p.m. Doors open at 4. And it's going to be at St. Mark Missionary Baptist Church, 2714 Frederick Boulevard, Portsmouth, Virginia, 2704. Contact Elonda Godwin at 537-6531 or Linda Finney at 735-1299. That's how you get your tickets. If you're online, you can rewind and you can get this information once again. I will be seeing you on tomorrow, Reverend Maurice Yancey. God be with you and One Accord. And I just want y'all to say, I did tell y'all I had a piercing, but let me tell you what happened. My body rejected the piercing. The piercing came out, and it was so funny because my piercing wasn't lined up correctly. It was crazy. Miss G told me don't get it, but I'm hard-headed at times. But my body rejected it, and it came right on out. So God took care of that all together. I just want y'all to know whatever you decide to do it in good and decent order and do it for unto the Lord. God loves you. I love you. Make sure you love yourself and you go on and love on somebody else, because you can't love someone if you don't love yourself. But with the love of God, we can do anything, all things through him. So what y'all gonna do on this beautiful Saturday? I just want y'all to know that whatever you do, know that God loves you. God bless you, and I will see you on next week.
15 minutes, you have been listening to the Love Spot radio broadcast with your radio minister, Minister Love. Make sure you stay tuned once again on next Saturday morning at the 11 o'clock a.m. hour for the same. You're in tune to 1400 AM WPCE. I'm the Brother Donald L. Eason. Good morning.
I just love his voice, y'all. I love his voice. Doesn't he have an awesome voice? But look, whatever y'all decide to do, one thing we need to remember is not to judge each other. We can do some Christianly judging, but why? Because we all do wrong. We all make mistakes. We all do something that someone else is not pleased with. So why don't we just mind our own business? The Bible tells us that too, to mind our business. And stop trying to judge others, because we're all doing something that is not pleasing to someone else. So if you decide to do whatever it is that you decide to do, I'm going to love you anyhow. And I'm going to love you through it. And even though I may not be able to reach you, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray that God continues to guide you. And even if you're on the wrong track, and I pray that if it's me that's on the wrong track, that you will pray for me and pray that I get back on the road that I need to be on. And that's the way we make it. We can't continue to put each other down, to laugh at each other, to talk about each other. We got to pray for each other, because prayer is what changes things. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I think I'm going to enjoy this beautiful day. And it might be a little windy, it might be even wet, but any day to be able to share with God's people, to smile at someone, to just give somebody a nod, a word of encouragement, is a beautiful day. I have my ups and downs, y'all. I tell y'all about my flaws. I'm not perfect at all. And sometimes the enemy creeps in through my weaknesses. But let me tell you, I know who saves me. I know whose I am. And I know who I can turn to for more strength, because we all need strength every day. And I just advise you to pray for strength to keep moving in the right direction. We have the power to step on the enemy's head, to step on the serpent's head. We have that power. We need to start executing our power that God has given us. Don't be afraid to use it. Don't be afraid to call on him, myself included. We can overcome any wiles of the enemy. Put on your whole armor of God and be mentally ready for his attacks, because when you come to God and you profess to be that you're going to serve him, the enemy attacks more. He doesn't have to worry about those already in the street being worldly. He got to worry about gaining the ones that say they're going to serve the Lord. And I just ask you to be prepared. Be prepared mentally. You may have to hang with some different folks, but that's okay. God is the friend that we need. He is our guide. He's our protector, our comforter. If you don't believe me, you just try me, because a lot of times I be sitting here and I'm like, what, God, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And he answers me. And if he doesn't ask me at that time, he calms my spirit. He takes away that worry, because he reminds me, I didn't give you that spirit of fear, but I gave you the power, the love, and a sound mind. That is what I gave you. I need you to use it, and I need you to trust me. And I just said, you know, give you that same advice. Just trust him. Tell him what you want. Trust him. Go out and get your dreams. It's never too late. I'm looking at about 3-4 million. That's all I ask God for. I ain't trying to be wealthy and as far as, you know, have to have hundreds of millions of dollars. I just need to be comfortable so that when I go out and work for God, I can just come to a comfortable spot, have my peace. And when I want to share with somebody, I want to be able to just know that I have it. And I believe that God is going to provide. I believe him for this, because he didn't bring me this far to leave me. I was a mess. God gave me a message. And if you haven't read my testimony, I need you to get the book. It's called But You're a Minister. Go to my site, my website. I'm about to put it on one of this page, and I put it on the other one. Get that book, and it'll tell you how messed up I was. I mean, I was not a good person at all. I was cold. I was heartless. I was a manipulator. But the whole thing of it, y'all, I was hurt. I was hurt, and I allowed my hurt to make the wrong decisions, to cause me to make the wrong decisions. And so I want to tell other people and show other people that you don't have to give in to the situations that life puts you in. You may be hurt, but there is a God that will be close to you. The brokenhearted, they say he's close to the brokenhearted. And I know that if had I went to him, I would have been a lot further than I am now. And then, you know, but I always remember when, you know, you think about why me, Lord. And my grandma used to always say, why not you? And I'd say that now, because it's like, had it not been me, I would not have a testimony for his people. So if it took me to go through that storm for over 20 years, if it took me to go through that storm just to have a testimony to be able to help somebody else, I am glad it was me. And I will do it again to help somebody else. See, that's growth. I am never ever been that given before. 25 years ago, I wouldn't have been thinking about anybody else. But look at God. He has changed me, and I am all in for serving him and his people. And with that said, y'all enjoy your weekend, and I will see you sometime this week. I need to do a Love Spot extension. So check my website out. Get your book, $15, $5 shipping and handling, or you can contact me directly and we can make arrangements for you to pick up your book. I'll sign it for you and everything. Now don't let me get too busy where I don't have time to sign your book and you don't have my John Hancock, because I know God didn't have me write this book for nothing. It's for somebody, and it's going to reach millions. I call it, I claim it, I declare it. This book is going to help millions of people. God bless you. Until we meet again, amen.